my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Learn to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame,
how that oftentimes God directs us and brings us to a point where there is a passage of scripture that God has kind of laid on your heart to think through. And that has been what's happened over the last 2 weeks as I've thought about where to go from here and what we're going to study over the video series for the next few weeks. And God has brought my attention to John chapter 15, specifically verses 1 through 17. And my goal is to encourage you that over the next few weeks, take maybe one time a week, sit down and read John chapter 15, verses 1 through 17, as we think through the concepts and the principles that are found in the text. Let me take a moment, and I'd like to read for you John chapter 15, verses 1 through 17. God's word says this: I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and they throw them into the fire, and they're burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you may bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. As the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give you. These things I command you, that you love one another. Before we really dig into the passage over the next few weeks, I want to take some time today to help us understand some historical information with regards to the passage. John, in the text here, as he is preparing and he writes his book, he is specifically writing to Jews. So often when we read John, we can miss some of the huge connections to the Old Testament or things that the Jewish people, who John is writing to, connections that they would make that are common knowledge to them that really nowadays we miss because we don't have some of the similar thoughts or connections to the Old Testament. And so I want to focus in today on what Jesus says, that phrase, "I am the true vine." And really think through that concept throughout the whole passage and into the Old Testament and then what John was saying. So I want to start right now just with the whole Jewish perspective. When you think, when Jesus says, "I am the true vine," over and over in the Old Testament scriptures, Israel is called God's vineyard. This is found in Isaiah 5, Isaiah 27, Jeremiah 2, Exodus 15, Exodus 19, Hosea 10, and then Psalm 90. And there's several others, but those are the main ones that talk about how that Israel is God's vineyard. And so I want to read one of those passages to you. I'm going to give you a little bit of time. We're going to turn to Isaiah chapter 5, and I'm going to read the first two verses. So turn with me to Isaiah chapter 5. Hopefully you got there. Isaiah chapter 5. I'm going to read the first two verses. This is what's called the famous song of the vineyard within scripture. And so here is what it says. "Now let me sing to my well-beloved a song of my beloved regarding his vineyard. My well-beloved has a vineyard on a very fruitful hill. He dug it up and cleared out its stones and planted it with the choicest vine. He built a tower in the midst and also made a wine press in it. So he expected it to bring forth good grapes, but it brought forth wild grapes." You can turn back to John 15. When you think about those verses, God specifically chose Israel as his chosen people. He had invested in her. He had done all these things like that. So Isaiah says, he's given her great leaders. He's given her prophets. He's given her the law, given her the covenants. These are all great for his chosen people. The picture is that God has carefully cultivated this vineyard, just like a owner of a vineyard would do, with the expectation of a harvest, for it to produce or yield fruit. But there was a problem. In the text, it says that it produced sour or bad fruit. Were they implying in a way that the Jews were not producing the kind of fruit they should be? Maybe they weren't a blessing to all nations like they were supposed to be. Maybe did the nation of Israel come to God, but really weren't a testimony of obedience and of honoring God and the covenants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? These are all questions you can ask yourselves, but truly Israel believed that they were the vine. And from a Jewish perspective, that was what was most important, that they were the vine. The issue is, even in the Old Testament, when you look at it, God was referring to them as the vineyard or the branches. Jesus actually addresses this same issue in Mark chapter 12. And I want to read just a summary of that verse that Kostenberger puts together, just a summary of those verses and what it says. "There was a man planting a vineyard. He put a wall around it, and he dug a pit for the winepress and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and went away on a journey. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants to collect from them some of the fruit of the vineyard. But they seized him, they beat him, and sent him away empty-handed. Then he sent another servant to them, and they struck this man on the head and treated him shamefully and sent. So then the vineyard owner sent another, and this one they killed. The vineyard owner continued to send others, and these renters over and over would beat some they would kill. Finally, the owner had one left, his son, the one he loved. And he sent him last of all, saying, they have to respect him. But the tenants said to one another when the son came, this is the heir. Come, let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. So they took him, and they killed him, and threw him out of the vineyard. What then will the owner say of the vineyard? What will he do? Will he come and he kill those tenants? Will he give the vineyard to another? When you consider Mark chapter 12 and that parable that Jesus gives, this group of farmers in the passage, the renters, is exactly a picture of what Israel did. God had given Israel tons of blessing, and he expected fruit. He expected a good result for his investment, and it didn't happen. Israel was given land. Israel was given truth. Israel was given covenants. Israel was given the law. So much more. What did they produce for God? Israel, through all of this, in the Jewish perspective, they believed that they were the vine. The issue is they did not realize that they were a branch and were not producing the fruit, the kind of fruit that the vine dresser desired. So when you get to the Gospel of John, John is in a series of giving his I am statements, where he is directly addressing the thoughts in the Jewish perspective. The Jewish perspective was wrong. And John was addressing this from what Jesus said. There's a series of I am statements. And some of the things that John addresses is in John chapter 6, he addresses and says, Jesus is the bread of life. In John chapter 8, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. John chapter 10, Jesus says, I am the door of the sheep and the good shepherd. In John 11, Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. In John 14, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Then you get to this John 15, and this is where Jesus says, I am the true vine. In each of these, John is purposefully showing the distinction, showing the Jewish audience that Jesus is far better. He is superior. His way is the best way compared to the Jewish perspective and compared to the truth that they thought they knew. Now, we need to be careful here when we think about this, because John is not saying in our passage that the church in any way replaces Israel. He is actually just pointing out to the Jews that they are not the vine. They are not the center of religion. They are not the center of all life. That Jesus is the true vine. That Jesus has replaced the system of religion that they had seemed to have created. John was pointing out that Jesus was the fulfillment of the replacement of the temple. That Jesus fulfilled the channel through which God's blessings would flow. And he is the one who will lead, who will guide, who will sustain them to actually produce fruit. Simply put, Jesus now replaces Israel as the focus of God's plan of salvation. Salvation has always been the same through faith, but now the focus is on Jesus rather than in the Old Testament faith through the law. This is a huge change, a huge paradigm shift in their thinking, because faith in Jesus actually supersedes keeping the law. Romans chapter 10 verse 4 says, Christ is the end of the law. This means that Jesus was literally its fulfillment, its replacement. Jesus did not leave Israel out of the picture forever. He wasn't just going to discard the branch, cut it off, and throw it to the wolves and the fire. He actually is going to redeem that. That's what's beautiful, because when Christ comes back, that is when God is going to deal and interact with Israel again. So when John's original audience hears this phrase, Jesus is the true vine, or I am the true vine, this points out some key things that Israel need to realize. The first is the Jewish nation, made up of all of these religious and political leaders, these spiritual giants of the day, had actually rejected the Messiah. Whoa. Heavy. And that would have struck these Jewish people from their perspective. And this is the one that God had to raise from the dead, who would redeem mankind, pay the price for our sin that we could not pay. That's significant. The second concept that the Jewish people had to realize here is that the Jews might think that their job, their responsibility, was to invite others in the world to join their chosen race, their chosen people, their chosen system of religion. This was their purpose. But now that was changed upside down. Now God works through the true disciples of Christ who are inviting others to join the mission of the Messiah. That the responsibility here was to invite the Jews to follow after the Messiah, follow after Jesus as the one who had the true mission. That's a change in perspective and how they're thinking. The third thing, and I said this a little earlier, but simply put, Israel was not the vine. They were just another branch. Jesus, the whole time, has been the vine. They were supposed to rely on God for everything. The law was to point them to the Messiah, point them to true truth. So as we start looking at John chapter 15, let me remind you of the same truth that the Jewish audience of John needed to be reminded of. We are not the vine. The church building that I am standing in is not the vine. The church community that someday will meet in the auditorium right over here is not the vine. Israel wasn't even the vine. Jesus is the true vine. And in him, we find our refuge. We find our strength. In him, we trust. In him, we learn. We grow to honor and glorify God. In him, we are empowered for service. Jesus is the true and living vine.
Who has held the oceans in his hand? Who has numbered every grain of sand? Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice. Behold our God, seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King. Nothing can compare. Come, upon his hand.